Hi, and welcome to the Bookish Stitcher podcast. My name is Jeanette. You can find me on Ravelry, Instagram, and Goodreads as Bookish Stitcher, all one word. I hope you've had an amazing week since I last recorded. As you can see behind me, we've started decorating for Halloween, and my kids were saying, oh, this is my favorite time of year because we love decorating the house and things like that, so it's a lot of fun. And you can see I have, you know, a little owl back there, and that's a little craft that my son put together. It's a thing like a 3D puzzle almost, where you piece together ghosts and a little dripping candle and all kinds of stuff. And then we're slowly decorating the whole house for Halloween, and we're gonna do the yard and everything like that. And it's been a really fun family weekend because my son's birthday is tomorrow, and I can't believe how old he's turning. It's just time goes by so fast. And yesterday we asked him, my husband was like, we should do something special because, you know, we're going to hopefully do a birthday party for him because it's a big birthday, and have friends and stuff like that. We can't do it here at the house yet because some of you may remember our house was flooded in July, and some of it's fixed, but not all of it. Like, the stuff isn't put back into the bathroom, and if you're having a party, you might want to have a toilet and sink that people can use at your house, so we couldn't have it here, but We're working out stuff for that. But we asked my son what he wanted to do yesterday, and he said he wanted to go to SeaWorld, which we live in San Antonio, and the SeaWorld's in San Antonio as well. It's kind of the opposite side of town from us. And so we drove over there, and the most awesome blessing happened. And so we were there getting in line, and I was a little bit stressed about it because I always stress over stuff like this. And my husband was like, oh yeah, we'll have a birthday party for him, we'll go to SeaWorld. And I was like, well, we should do one or the other because, you know, birthday parties cost money, SeaWorld costs money. And as you guys, anybody who knows who's been to like a big amusement park knows that it's expensive to go there, a family of four and stuff like that. So we're standing in line to get tickets, and I was kind of stressed out about it. And these girls came, and I guess it was military day there. San Antonio has a very large military population. And these young girls came up to us, or came up to me, and they said, we have extra tickets that we'd like to give you. And I like hugged her and was like, oh my gosh. And they had three extra tickets. And so they gave us their three tickets. That was so sweet. And then we were in line waiting so we could buy a fourth ticket. And there were these grandparents there taking their granddaughter to SeaWorld for the day, and they gave us another extra ticket that they had, and they gave it to us. We did not have to pay. We bought food and stuff at the park, but we did not have to pay to get into the park, which was amazing because the tickets there are really expensive. And I was just like blown away by the whole thing. It was just so awesome, and just such, like, you know, you're feeling stressed about it, and then just like something amazing happens. And I can't wait till we're at a point, you know, with the grandparents that were, you know, gifting us. I can't wait till we're older and in a really good place, and we can do that and pay it forward and gift other people, you know, free, like, things to that. I'm so excited for when we're older and we can do that. And it was also a great day because my daughter got to go on her first little kid roller coaster, and she loved it. And my son got to go on his first, like, adult big roller coaster, and I was surprised when he said he wanted to ride it, but he said he did. So he went on that, and he actually liked it. I was holding my daughter's hand because she couldn't go on it. We were down waiting for them, and I was holding her hand. I was like, poor Jaden, because I thought that he was going to freak out, but he loved it. So that was a huge surprise, and it was just a great day, and so it was so much fun. I take a sip of my tea. This is actually one of my, I'm going to talk about stitches this week because I didn't last week because I was just too tired. But this is actually one of my things that I got at the stitches market. And it's a mug with a knitted sweater on it. And I have never had one of these. And I thought it was so cool looking. And it's in yellow. And yellow, as I've talked about, is like a happy color for me. And I only have one other yellow mug. So, and tea is really good. I'm actually having some special tea because somebody else I got to meet at the Stitches Market, Erica, a simple motif, I got to hug her in person, and we exchanged some little goodies with each other, and she gifted me this tea that she said made her think of me. And it's not raining outside right now, so from now on, whenever I drink this tea, it will have to be raining. Like, that's a rule. But I wanted to drink it today, and she gifted me this. I don't know if you could see it. It says, Rainy Day Meditation. And it says, Sarioni Forest Road on a rainy day. And it is, it's really good tea. And I absolutely love it because it's rainy day meditation tea. And it's in Japanese. Maybe it has the hiragana or the katakana or kanji. But yeah, so that is really neat. I love it, Erica, and I hope you're having a good week. I was excited to get to meet her in person and her friends that she was shopping with at the market. But this tea is really good. It didn't need any sugar or any milk. It's just excellent on its own. And the mug that it's sitting in, I should show that. I got their business card. And it was inside the tea, but I didn't want to get soggy. I took it out. Polly Studios. Kind of blown out right there, but I don't want to show the address, but that's what it looks like. And they do all kinds of different things. It's a husband and wife team, and the husband was there selling stuff, I think. I don't know if the wife was there. I didn't get to meet her, but the wife does the actual pottery. They had videos up in their booth of her making the various things. So on to knitting. I have a funny finished object. So this is a test knit that I did, the Lightning Strike hat by Mina, Knitting Expat. And the knitting is finished on it, but as you'll see, the ball is still attached because it is a, oh, it's so pretty. It is a super bulky weight hat and it's knit on big needles, and I bought the yarn at the Stitches Market so I could do this test knit because I didn't have anything like this in my stash. And I ran out of yarn. The skein didn't have enough for what the pattern said that it needed exactly. So that was my fault. I should have gotten another skein at the market, but I was, you know, when you're trying to be overly optimistic and like, I can make this work. Well, should have listened. So I need a little bit more, and I already contacted the dyers. This is Twisted Owl Fiber Studio, and they have another skein of it, so I can get that. But I wanted to finish the test knit on time, and I did. I finished it a couple days ago, but this is some yarn that I held double, and it's just a chunky weight, I believe, chunky single, but I held it double so that I could finish the hat off, and you can definitely see where the color difference is. So what I'm gonna do, because I wanted to have it all done on time, is I just finished it, and then when I get the other skein of the Twisted Owl, I'm going to just take off the little bit of the crown decrease. So I was almost there. I just had a few rows of crown decreases left, like half of them, like five rows left. I was so close. But I'll take that out and I'll re-put it in the right color. It's a very similar color, but this is gonna be a gift maybe for my father-in-law for Christmas, because he lives up north, or more north than I live in Texas, and I think that a bulky weight hat might be a good idea for him. And it looks massive, like it could be a guy hat. It could be a girl hat or a guy hat, but the Lightning Strike and then the color gray, I think it could definitely probably be an okay guy hat. So thank you, Mina, for letting me test knit. That was super fun, and I've been on such a hat kick lately, so that was perfect. It was almost a week of like all the Mina finished objects because I worked on some other stuff too, but let me show you my next thing in here. This is another, well, I didn't buy this. This is a Stitches acquisition. Java Jenny, who does the Kitchen Counter Crafter, Kitchen Counter Crafter. She traded with me, so I gave her some yarn because she liked the tweed, and then she said, you know, pick some stuff from my shop. So that was so fun to get to trade, and so sweet of her to do that. So thank you, Java Jenny. It was so nice to hug you too. And this is a bag that I picked up because doesn't that remind you of the Open Skies, the yarn logo? Look, it's a happy cloud and it's raining and rain is happy. So one of my friends that I was at the market with, she was like, maybe you should talk a little less about rain. But I can't. But so anyways, there was the rainbow interior. It's just the most adorable bag. And I don't know if she has any left in her shop, but you could definitely contact her and ask. Look at this, a sleepy cloud, and it's such a great bag. So this is one that I just got to trade yarn for a bag, and that was awesome. And then in here is another test knit, and it's another one for Mina. And this is, she's so sweetly, last year I had bought, probably around this time, I had bought a bag for me, a Christmas bag. And she so sweetly sent along two extra bags, a bag for my son and then a bag for a giveaway. And I knew that I wanted to like gift her back something it took me a while to get around to, but I had some rainbow fiber that I wanted to spin up for her. And then since I had started dyeing yarn, I was like, oh, can I send you a skein of yarn? And she so sweetly designed a pattern up in my yarn, and then she named it after the yarn company, which was just so wonderful. Thank you, Mina, you're so sweet. And congratulations on the baby. But so this is the Open Skies hat. And I got this yarn at the market too because one of my best local friends here in San Antonio is having a birthday, and she and her daughter are taking a mother-daughter trip to New York City, and it's going to be there, they're going to be there during Christmas time or a little bit before Christmas, but it's cold there, and she, if it's air conditioning, she needs a coat. So she gets super cold, so she's great to knit for, and her favorite color is green to wear. And so I'm knitting this for her. So I bought the yarn there at the market. This is her birthday present. Birthday present, buying her the yarn and then knitting up the hat. And it has these gorgeous cables and this wonderful squishy folded brim. So I think that that will be great keeping her warm while she's in New York. And that's just a little progress marker that I'm using to count my rows. I'm almost done with this. I really thought I would have been done, but this week I just did not knit anywhere near as much as I normally knit. Like, this is probably the least amount of knitting I've done ever since I started knitting. I, you know, just been not knitting. But so this is the Gynx yarn in the Dragon's Egg colorway. And it's a lot of fun. It's a great pattern, especially if you love cables like I do. And I just have a cable needle that I've been using. I'm almost done with that. And then the next thing, really didn't get much worked on this week, but I did knit on it a lot last week, and I didn't show it last week because I was trying to keep it short and kind of in a time crunch. Oh, this tea is just so good, Erica. It's just so yummy. And I can't I normally don't drink tea black like this, but this is amazing. It's probably because it's rainy day and it's from Erica, so it has to be amazing. But in a bag that was so sweetly gifted to me, I have a Halloween bag, and I'm going to be bringing out the Halloween bags because it's Halloween time, Halloween decorations. And then this, like I said, I cast on last week, and this is the jewel hat. I don't remember. It'll be in the show notes. I will do those. And this is one of my, I think this was my oldest skein of yarn. Still in my stash. I'm working towards that goal of getting out every yarn this year that was before 2015. And so this is Tempted, and it is in the Foliage colorway. And it's gorgeous. And it looks highly variegated in the cake, right? And I was a little bit nervous about it working for this pattern. But then, because that Tempted, she's such a genius, it knits up very nicely. And it is just, it's like the simplest hat pattern. And then there I have one of my little whimsy stitches, deer. Little ones. But it is just the simplest hat pattern. I probably could have figured it out on my own instead of purchasing the pattern, but I love to support designers that are doing really awesome things. So the hat pattern, I can't remember the designer's name right now though, but I'll have that, like I said, in the show notes. And this is a perfect hat size bag, and I'm loving it, and it's going to go back there now, and it can be festive next to all the other Halloween stuff. So that's really all I worked on. I did work on a little bit my driftwood socks that Mina also designed. And I'm close to getting those done, but then I was like, I need to focus on the test knits, so I put those down. But that's all of the knitting stuff. Like I said, I just haven't been knitting that much. We had a couple cooler days here, and this is like the only thing I posted on Instagram this week, this and then the giveaway for the group, which I'll talk about in group news, but it was cooler here, and I had listened to a TED Talk recently, and it was talking about how, you know, a lot of people will go for walks at their gym or go for walks in their neighborhood, which is kind of what I do when the weather cools off. But they said for people that suffer with depression and anxiety and all those different kinds of things, and I've talked about on the podcast stuff before, but that going out in actual nature, where there are deers and there are birds and there are squirrels and there are streams and any, you know, any kind of trees and stuff like that, instead of just concrete and houses, that it actually helps with depression a lot. And I have been having a rough couple of weeks. Hopefully it hasn't shown on the podcast, but I've been having a rough couple of weeks. And I just thought I would give this a try. So the one day that it was cool enough, I went down on my lunch break and I just went and I walked the entire hour out in nature. And it was probably a very slow walk because I kept encountering deer and they almost came up and touched my hand. And I was texting my husband. I was like, this is magical. And I felt very good for that hour when I was out there in the nature. So, and it did carry on a little bit into the day, but hopefully as the weather cools off and I can do that more, that will kind of help with some stuff that been too much in my own head lately. But that's kind of why I didn't get as much knitting done. And then in the evenings, I was just kind of lying in my bed, not knitting, not really doing much of anything. So it's kind of, that's why. But tomorrow starts something very special and awesome. And I'm going to try to like gather all my good feeling energy and directed in one place and try to succeed at this, because during Tour de Fleece our house flooded, so I really kind of failed at that. And I wanted to, Spinzilla is coming up, it's starting tomorrow, and so I really wanted to make an effort to do amazing at Spinzilla so that I can kind of feel better about myself having failed so horribly at Tour de Fleece. And so last year during Spinzilla, I spun 6 braids of fiber. If you don't, for those of you that don't know, Spinzilla is a 7-day spinning competition where you spin as much as you possibly can, and you just see how much you can get done, and you're in teams, and you compete for who will get the highest amount spun and all that kind of stuff. So it's fun, and a couple of my friends are on my team that I know, and so it's fun to see what they're working on and all that kind of stuff. So since I had done 6 last year, this is kind of a hugely ambitious goal, but I decided, and I'm not going to go over it all this week because next week I'm going to have a special like spinning video. I decided it would be fun. I'll show my wheel. I'll show how I prep fiber. I'll show, talk about all the fiber and stuff like that. So there will be a segment that's filmed at a separate time next week that you'll see all the spinning stuff, which I thought would be nice. But I'll just show this really quickly. This is all of my fiber that I plan to spin for Spinzilla. Okay. So this looks like a ton, but it's just 10 braids of fiber. It's just 10 braids of fiber in there. Because last year I spun 6. So this year I'm going to try for 10. I'll talk about this, what I keep my fiber in and stuff like that in the video next time. But that's almost all of the fiber that I have, 10 braids. I don't have a ton because the other fiber that I have is kind of in gradient. So I want to spin very simple stuff that will spin up fast, and I won't have to worry about doing a lot of, like when I ply it, I won't have to worry about chain plying and taking time. I can just zoom through, two plying, zoom through, zoom through. So that's my goal. And I'm hoping to just knock that out of the park. I really think that that would help kind of give me a little happiness mood boost if I could take that goal and meet it. And if I exceed it, that would be amazing. So wish me luck. And if you're doing Spinzilla or, you know, anything like that, I would love to hear about it. And hopefully my spinning video next week will enable you to start spinning, because I never thought I would spin. I always said I don't need a step between me and yarn. And now I never knew I would love spinning so much. So that's spinning. And then now I do a little bit of enabling talk. So at the Stitches Market, I drove up to Stitches Friday and I had an audiobook that was wonderful, and I'll be talking about this week. And I got there on Friday and I just got there too late for the market, so then I went out to dinner. We stayed at a hotel with some friends. They were all stayed there at the same place, can get discount rates. And then it's within walking distance of different things. So we went to a Mexican restaurant for dinner, and then walked back, and we just sat and knit in the little lobby for a while. And then I went to bed around 10, 9:30, 10, and they went to the pajama party. Stitches has this big pajama party event where you can win all kinds of prizes, and it's this big party. And I am an introvert, so the idea of going for a 2-hour, 10 p.m. to midnight party and getting home, getting back to the hotel at around 1 and being super tired for the next day, I just couldn't do it. So then Saturday morning, woke up and we had breakfast and we went to the market. And the first booth that I stopped at had to support my friends who were there vending. So, let's see. I got some Night Owl fibers in the Here Comes the Sun colorway. And it's going to be kind of blown out, but it is this light buttercream yellow, kind of a vintage looking, and a light pink with speckled portions in it in a white. And I think this will be very pretty. She had so wonderfully samples of all her self-striping sock knit up on a little board so you could see. And I never would have picked this colorway in this game, ever. But then I saw the sample knit up, and I saw how it looked. It had this very kind of vintage feel to it, and I thought that was beautiful. So, and it could be socks for my daughter too. She would love these, and she's been asking for some socks. So I really need to get some on the needles for her. And then I wanted to support my other friend, Heidi, who was there vending. And they were actually right next door to each other. And Heidi has undead yarn. And so this is some of her bulky, which I think will make a great hat. It's a self-striping bulky. So love those colors. I think they'll look good on a hat for me. And so I got that. And then I wanted to focus on stuff that wasn't really yarn as well this time. So I got this, which is something I've been wanting and needing because of something fun I'm going to do next year, which I'll talk about when it gets closer to next year. But I always have different themes for the year. Like this year is using up scraps, and the year before was using up your 15 oldest skeins. So kind of a hint into next year's theme. But I got Interpretations Volume 3, and this is a Vera Valamaki pattern on the front, which I will be knitting. And so I needed this, because there's another pattern in here that I want to knit as well. And there are a bunch of patterns in here that I want to knit as well. And so it's cheaper to buy the book than to buy a whole bunch of patterns individually. And then this next thing I got, this is very cool. I have wanted, you see those things where you kick up your yarn, and then you have, there's these nice wooden ones, and you put it on there, and it kind of spins around as it goes. But the wooden ones, you know, they're often very pricey, too pricey for me, especially with a four-year-old who likes to break everything. And I'm not at that stage in my life where I can have really nice things and expect them to be like to where they'll last and they'll be, you know, so I never got one of those. But there was this new thing, I'd never seen this before. This new thing there called Yarn Valet, and they had, it's plastic, but it's nice quality plastic, super cheap, like a fifth of the price of what a wooden yarn thing was. It was like $12 or something for this, and $12, $15, but this is one of those things. And so you sit your cake of yarn on here, and it spins, and... oh, you can't see it, but right here, aha, there you go. There's a ruler, and you can sit your pattern right here, which is very, very clever. It has little, gauge things for it, but this is, and, you know, these were all made in the USA, which is very cool. It's fun to get stuff like that, and it has how-to videos at yarnvalet.com, and this is what it looks like. So I'm excited to use this and see how it works. But they had tons of other very clever little things like this. So definitely go check them out if you, you know, are looking for clever gadgety stuff that is very inexpensive, which is great for me right now with stage of life. And then, like I said, Java Jenny is so sweet and let me trade yarn for bags. But I wanted to get something for my daughter because my daughter, I saw this sign out somewhere and it was saying about how when you support small businesses that, you know, you're helping a mom put her daughter through dance class. You're not like if you're supporting big corporations or something, buying somebody their third vacation home or something. And so I saw that sign and I was like, oh, Faye has always wanted to take dance classes. And now I'm dying yarn. I could finally put her in dance classes. So that's one thing I did. But so she's in dance class and it's adorable. I should take a picture of her. But she need all the other little kids have like these embroidered bags with their name on them and ballet shoes and very fancy. And I don't even want to think how much those cost them. But Jenny, Java Jenny, had this cute bag. My daughter loves My Little Ponies. And so now she can have something kind of cute and fun. Well, very cute and fun. And I could even maybe hand stitch her name onto it so it could be like the other kids' fancy stuff. And it, her ballet and tap shoes can go in here. And that will be just perfect. So I'm excited for that. It's so cute. So thank you, Jenny. And then the last thing that I have been wanting to do, there's several of those three color shawls out there, and I've been wanting to do them for so long, but I didn't have the right combination of yarns in my stash. So there was this one booth there that had just walls and walls of color and amazingly priced stuff. Their prices were great. And so I decided to get three skeins of yarn that were there, that were matching. I knew they would match. I knew they would go because they were, I got them all at the same time. And these are the three that I chose. I'm not sure which of my three pattern, or three color patterns they're going to be yet, but I have lots of ones that I want in it. But it's kind of a muted palette. I'm sorry. This is called Sand Dune. This one is called, where you go, Pink Bliss and Bon Voyage. And this is from, oh gosh, okay, I can't read the, Stunning String Studio. Sorry, it's very cursive-y script and I couldn't read this. Stunning String Studio. They are on Etsy, so if you're looking for amazingly priced, large selection of colors, I would definitely recommend them. So those are going to be a three color shawl. Maybe the Random Act of Color or the three color cashmere shawl or something like that, but that's what those will be. So that is all of my enabling from the market. And yeah, it was just a great day. And then I had a friend that I had spun her up some hand spun because we were at a retreat once and she had said that she really likes barber pulling. I was like, oh, can I, you know, spin you up some hand spun and give it to her? So I had some hand spun for her because I've been really on a spinning kick for other people right now. And she said, yay, that would be awesome. And she asked if she could bring me some stuff from the Japanese dollar store. We do not have one of these in San Antonio that I'm aware of. But they have two in Dallas, and this is the most amazing place ever. I think if we had one here, I'd be in trouble. Or I'd just be an amazing awesomeness. But she got me this humongous bag of stuff from Daiso Japan, and hopefully I'm saying that right, but in here, I'm not even going to show you all of it because that would take forever, but she had snacks for my kids, like those, the kids have already eaten them, but I haven't saved the package, all kinds of different snacks, there's still some stuff left, the kids haven't eaten, there was just so much in here, a little pin set for my daughter. And the thing that I really loved, these have been so useful because they're little cards and I've been putting them in orders for the shop. Like when somebody orders a skein of yarn, I put a little card in there, a little thank you note. So these are super cute little owls. And I haven't been able to find anything like that here. And then this is very cute, a little Yama notepad, or maybe it's not a pocket. But, and then shoebox with matryoshkas, which I can't believe. It was so funny that there was one of these in the Japanese store, but it was like perfect. And she's in some candy. So not everything has been eaten, but in some green tea. And then she found yarn. How cute is this? She's like, this is the crappiest yarn, but it's just adorable. You just want it because it's so cute. But yeah, she found yarn. And so there's just so much stuff in there. And then also, like I said, I was with the tea that I got to meet Erica, a simple motif, and she gave me, I still haven't eaten this. I'm surprised at myself. But a lint bar, which is so amazing. My daughter will probably eat that as soon as she loves chocolate. And then some little mini skeins, which are so cute. And I need to work on my mini skein blanket. And then some Le Petit Prince, the little prince stitch markers. Look at that. It's the little prince right there. And you can see him. I still need to watch the Netflix of that. But yay. Thank you so much, Erica and Tasha, for my wonderful little goodie bags that were so sweet for you guys, from you guys. And so I think that is everything. Oh, group news. We have a giveaway going on in the group right now. I'm going to give it one more week so that, you know, hopefully everybody that wants to enter can see it. And I post it on Instagram too, because I know a lot of people, people always tell me when I meet them, they're like, oh, you know, I don't have time to watch the podcasts right away and I miss the giveaways. And so I try to post on there too to give people chances, you know, if you're having a busy week and you get behind or stuff like that. But so that was one more week that will be up for that, and it's in the Bookish Stitcher podcast group on Ravelry, and I had all the information's up on there on how to enter. And it's for a gorgeous skein of Gynx yarn in the November rainbow. And yeah, so Spinzilla next week and all that fun stuff. And since I'm planning on spinning up a ton, some of those braids that I spin up are going to go for giveaway for the podcast group. And then I definitely want to do some more hand-spun giveaways for the Patreon, because I appreciate you guys who donate to the Patreon so much, because I mailed out so many packages this week, and then I still have more prizes to mail out next week because I finished dyeing up the yarn for the prize winners for that. And so those will go out. So helping with the postage stuff is just so amazing of everyone that does that. So thank you so much to all the Patreon donors, and I will have some hand-spun goodness for you coming up in a giveaway in October. So that will be lots of fun, and I'll let you kind of pick which braid you want of the ones that I spun up during Spinzilla. But I think that's everything except for the book, which is good, right? Because longer. And at the end, there's going to be a special, like I said, segment of the stitches. I took video at the market. Yay! I've been wanting to do that. I always forget. So I took video at the market, and I'm going to put it to some music. My husband's going to put it to some music. Okay, he's wonderful. You guys already know. I've said that a million times. But he's going to put it to me. And he always asks me, he's like, can I put more videos in your podcast? Because he loves doing it. He's like, can I put you an introduction? And I'm like, whoa, wait a second. I can't be too fancy. But he wants to do all that. So I thought that that would be fun to like have him do that. And he'll do next week's spinning stuff, kind of help film it and everything. So that will be kind of a fun project to do together, where I can sit next to him. And I'm the least picky person in the world on 99% of things, so I just like tell him whatever you want to do is fine. And so yeah, there, stay tuned for that. At the end there, after the book review, there will be a video of the stitches market for anybody who wants to see that. But the book this week is the one that I listened to on the way down to Stitches. I actually had 4 minutes left when I arrived there. And because it is October, I love doing like themed reading or themed knitting and stuff like that. So I decided that all of October would be Spooky Book Month, where every weekend, every time I podcast this month, I will review a different spooky book. Now, some of them, you know, might be horror, some might be YA, some might be cozy mystery, which I have never really read much of, and I'm excited to read so I can review one on the podcast. So it'll be just a whole wide berth of all the different genres that would be included in the Halloween kind of theme. So this first one was recommended to me by so many people, and it possibly is the weirdest and goriest book I've ever read, listened to. So the book was called Library at Mount Char. You know how well you can see it. The cover is very dark, but it's very easily recognized because that is a very artistically done cover. It was narrated by Hilary Huber, and it was 16 hours and 47 minutes, which it did not take me that long to get down to Dallas. Luckily this time the traffic was not bad and I made it in a normal amount of time. But it's very hard to describe this book. So there's this main character named Carolyn, and she is part of this group of people that were taken as children to this man who is kind of like a god, not with a capital G, like the G-O-D, kind of in the ancient tradition of like Greek gods and different things like that. Kind of a god, and he had taken all these children and to teach them different catalogs. And a catalog in this book is like each children has their specific area of expertise. Like this one might be good at languages, which is the one Carolyn was good at, which is maybe why people said I should read it, because I am mad in love with languages. But, you know, and one would be good at war. One would be good at healing. They all have their different catalogs that they study. And the kind of reason why he wants that done is he doesn't want any one of them to have too much power because he is the, like, figurehead. But he goes disappearing, and they can't find him, and so they're all searching around for him. And it deals a lot with Carolyn doing these random tasks and trying to find the way to get to the library, because the library at Mount Char is this area where her father kind of resides, her father's house. And it's heavily guarded. And so she kind of finds this innocent, unknowing American man to run, to do these tasks for her. And he gets in so much trouble, and he's wanted by everyone, and he goes to jail, but then they break him out. There's all this stuff that kind of, all these shenanigans that happen with him. And he just kind of keeps doing it, all these tasks, and doesn't really ever question why. But the book comes to describe like the complexities of that relationship and kind of why they are kind of tied together in these unusual ways. So the reason they're trying to find this way to the library is kind of a competition, and these kids all want to learn the most, and kind of they're not supposed to study each other's catalogs. That's against the law or against the rules, but they all are kind of secretly doing it. And it's very gruesome. It's very, very weird. If you like weird and you don't mind books where I think the first paragraph has the word maggots in it, then hey, there are some triggers that I do want to warn of in this book, because I didn't know of it going in, and I was driving on the highway to Dallas when one of the things I would definitely consider a trigger happened, and I was it was not good. If I could have stopped in the highway or gotten over and felt comfortable trying to get back on, if there was an off ramp, I would have gotten off and skipped this part, because this is something I can't listen to without getting very upset. But there is a scene where the main character, Carolyn, I don't want to say the word in case there are any kids listening in, but the R.A. by a boy named David, who's kind of the most horrible of the kids at this house, and that was very tough, and that's a trigger for you. Don't listen to at least that part of it, kind of towards the end. But I always like to say that because, you know, there are things that kind of certain specific things for each different person that are harder for them to listen to because of stuff that they've gone through in their past. But yeah, so it was a good book. It was very weird, and I don't even know. I think I gave it a 4 stars on Goodreads. I don't even know if I really actually liked it, or if it was just so unique. But if you like horror and you like gore and stuff like that, it could be a good Halloween time book. Then this book was called The Library at Mount Char by Scott Hawkins. I think I forgot to say his name. Scott Hawkins. And it was narrated by Hillary Huber. And so, yeah, that is all I have for this week. At the end, there's going to be the video of stitches, and I hope you enjoy that. And I'll see you guys next week, hopefully, with a whole bunch of spinning and a cool video on just different spinning stuff that I love and my wheel and fiber that I'm spinning and different preps that I do. So hope you enjoy that. And until next time, I hope you have a great week and that you get to do all the things you love. Okay, bye guys.